This is our first podcast of 2020, and we're so happy to have Rick back today because he's a return guest and he's provided us with such insightful and specific information about the current tennis landscape and what to look for in the future. We were talking earlier about the incredible superstars at the top three that we've been watching for all these years and how incredible it is that they've been able to dominate the tennis landscape for so long.
Absolutely. And so when we're talking about those top three players, we're talking about Djokovic, we're talking about Federer, mm-hmm. and we're talking about Nadal. And one of the things that makes 2020 such a special year is that all three of those players are competing to be the greatest of all time. And all three of them have a legitimate argument or a claim to say that they should be. Mm-hmm. But it really is going to come down to who wins the most Grand Slams. And so Roger has 20, mm-hmm. Nadal has 19, and Djokovic has 16, but Djokovic is the youngest of the three. So what that means for each one of these guys is that whoever wins slams during 2020 is really going to forward their argument for saying, I'm the greatest of all time, right? I've been the biggest winner. And I think that puts more interest and it also puts a little more pressure on these guys. But if I'm gonna rank those top three superstars, I have to put Djokovic number one, and let's go through the reasons. Mm-hmm. He won the Australian Open last year. Mm-hmm. He beat Nadal in the final. Not only that, if we look at how he's done at the beginning of this year, he was in the ATP Cup, and he was undefeated, and his country, Serbia, won the ATP Cup. And in the final, he beat Nadal in straight sets. Very convincing mm-hmm. win. So everything looks really strong for him.
And he's the youngest.
That's right. That's right. But, you know, I think you have to say anyone in that top three has a legitimate shot. Let's move down to number two. And I'd put Federer in the number two spot. And let's go through the reasons why. He won the Australian Open in 2018. He won the Australian Open in 2017. He obviously likes that service. He plays well there. He also understands how important this is to his career. He's got 20 Grand Slams, but Nadal's knocking on the door with 19, and Djokovic mm-hmm. is right there with 16. He's probably only got a year or two left before he retires.
I know, in the tennis magazine, they showed on the cover, they had a picture of him almost in a kissing goodbye motion, and I thought, oh, not yet, not yet.
And I'm a huge Federer fan, right? And you know, this year I'm planning to go to Indian Wells and I'll see him there. And I'm going to the French Open and I'm going to see him there.
Wow.
And I'm going to the US Open. And all of those things are because I think that there's a possibility that this could be his last year. And I just want to have those memories of seeing him play.
Yes.
But so I would definitely say Federer has the second best shot of the superstars, and then of course Nadal would be three, and he lost to Djokovic last year in the Australian Open final. Mm-hmm. If you're looking at and Djokovic has a winning record against Nadal, if you mm-hmm. look at the Federer-Nadal head-to-head and you just go back to the last seven matches, Federer's won 6 out of 7, and the one time that Nadal beat him was on clay. So, and of course, Nadal is the greatest of all time on clay, right? So, but I think in a hard court situation, you'd have to give Federer a slight advantage. Mm-hmm. But Nadal is the same thing. He's at 19. He needs to get these Grand Slam victories, and he doesn't have that many years left. And if he could find a way to win the Australian Open, that would be like a huge thing for him.
Aww.
The other thing is in total, right? Djokovic has 7 career Australian Opens mm-hmm. and Federer has 6 career Australian Opens. And so they have dominated sort of the Australian Open, although Federer has more of his earlier
right.
than Djokovic, right?
Right, and the suspense. And you know, just because Nadal and Federer were partners for one doubles match that I did see, maybe they were partners more often than that, and they seemed to get along famously, no, this rivalry is serious, and right. it's going to be history and making history. And so it's going to be a fascinating year in that regard, having seen them play together and now vying for this really crucial career win. I'm so glad that you have all the statistics. I didn't know the numbers that were relevant. And then after these three, we were talking about Federer, Nadal, and Djokovic. The young guns are coming up. And in the Americans especially, it's very fascinating who's coming up and who's going to be the next three or in the next 10 years.
Sure. So let's talk about when you say young guns, or some people say next generation players.
Next gen.
what I'm talking about is that players who are 23 years old or younger, right?
Uh-huh.
If you're older than that, then you don't qualify.
And too late for you. No.
So I'll go through the list that I see. So that would be Medvedev.
Mm-hmm.
That would be Tsitsipas.
Mm-hmm.
That would be Berrettini. And that would be Khachanov. Those mm-hmm. would be my top four next-gen players. And I definitely put Medvedev first. He's earned that right. First of all, he's the only one who made it to a Grand Slam final, and that was the U.S. Open. And, mm-hmm. of course, he lost a very close five-set match to mm-hmm. Nadal.
Painful.
Which was really impressive to see him push Nadal so hard in a fifth set. He had an amazing end of the year last year. I think he made it to six consecutive finals, and it's so hard to do that. And then if you look at the beginning of this year to see how he started, he was in the ATP Cup, and he's the only one who really pushed Djokovic.
Mm-hmm.
He lost a narrow three-set match to Djokovic, and the third set was 6-4. So he actually played Djokovic much tougher than Nadal did. And I think that he has a real chance to become the first next-gen player to win a slam.
Wow.
And that's impressive because he just really came onto the scene last year. Like he moved up so fast during 2019. Now, the next person I put number two in the next-gen category is Tsitsipas.
Mm-hmm.
Medvedev is 23, Tsitsipas is 21. So he's a little bit younger. He had a great 2018. That's when he broke onto the sort of the top 20, top 15 of men's tennis.
Mm-hmm. He didn't notice, here I am.
Right, he also had a good 2019, but not as good as Medvedev's. And it's not unusual for there to be a little bit of a sophomore slump when players figure out how to play you and everybody's gunning for you because you did so well. But he did finish off last year with the year-end ATP event in London, and mm-hmm. he won that, right?
Yeah.
Which is a big deal for him. And he would definitely be, of the next-gen players, the next player that would be ready to step up and win a Grand Slam.
Right, and he's got to get his act together and start getting the wins under his belt and all that experience, because there's another level of 18-year-olds coming up behind him.
Absolutely,
right?
Absolutely. Let me not just leave out quickly the other two next-gen players were Berrettini and Khachanov.
Right.
Berrettini came out of nowhere in 2019. He finished the year in the top 10. I think he was 8 at the end of the year. When a player does that, when they move up so fast, mm-hmm. you kind of have to wait till the next year to see whether there's going to be a little bit of a sophomore slump where mm-hmm. they dip. We've seen that with a lot of players.
Definitely.
Or whether they continue to play at that high level, and then you know they're for real. They're going to be a great player in there.
Yeah, second year after the breakout is really telling.
For Berrettini will be big, and he's also a player, you know, he's got a big serve, he's got a big forehand. He could develop into a better mover.
Right.
He has a few weaknesses in his game, and we'll see if he is able to improve and become a stronger player in 2020, mm-hmm. or whether he sort of levels off, right? And right. then the last person is Khachanov. And with him, he's not quite at the level of those, you know, the first three we talked about mm-hmm. are all top 10 players. Khachanov's in the top 20. And he hasn't progressed quite as fast. But he's got a huge serve. He's got a huge forehand. Mm-hmm. And if he is able to be a more consistent player and maybe develop a few defensive skills, mm-hmm. He definitely has the game that he could go on to be a Grand Slam. Right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then there's those the 18-year-olds that are coming up right behind them. So a few of them you mentioned earlier. Felix was one. And
sure. So, and these players, I don't think, have a legitimate chance to win a Grand Slam yet. They're too young. Their games are evolving. But it's really interesting to catch them at this early right. stage in their career and watch them move up and progress, right? Mm-hmm. So any one of these guys. So Felix is the Canadian. He's got a great game. Shapovalov is also mm-hmm. another Canadian right. kid who's got an amazing game. There's another Sinner, S-I-N-N-E-R, mm-hmm. won the Next Gen tournament at the end of last year. And all of them, like
Demonar?
I said, there's
Demonar
from uh-huh. Australia, absolutely, mm-hmm. is another young, talented player. I know there's a lot of American people
right.
that are looking, well, what about us,
good
right?
Good catch.
Who's yes. going to be the next U.S. star, right? And,
yes.
and look, you know, we had Sampras and we had Agassi and we had Roddick, and now we're sort of in a little bit of a drought in terms of Grand Slams. And if you're looking down the draw, who's going to be the next guy?
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to look at Francis Tiafoe,
yes.
Who has improved enormously and is extremely athletic, right?
Mm-hmm.
So has a lot of potential there. Taylor Fritz is another guy who has, you know, great potential. They're both young. They both have a lot of time to develop.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they're not up at the level of a Medvedev or a Tsitsipas, but they have
potential,
right? And if you want to watch young American players who maybe a year or two from now are going to be able to challenge at a Grand Slam event, those would be the guys that you'd want to pay attention to and see how their game evolves over the next couple of years.
Mm, good point. I can't thank you enough for all of this great information today.
Well, first of all, it's a pleasure to be here. I love doing this. But secondly, I can't tell you how excited I am. You know, it's the beginning of the year. And you know, there's so many matchups and so many things that are at stake in tennis. It's just really exciting, right? I'm so excited that I'm going to be glued to the TV set for the Australian. And like I said, I'm going to be at Indian Wells. I'm
going
to be at the
French. You're going to be there. And then you'll come back and tell us about your experience, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, that's a deal. I can't wait. Oh, thank you so much, Rick.
Well, thank you for having me.
Great,
I loved it.
Great information.